Thank you. how are you?
Doing well.
Didn't sound like that was a confident, I'm doing well.
Oh, I'm doing well.
There you go.
Yeah, I was feeling sad for a few days, but
oh, that's
now
okay.
I'm okay.
Everybody can feel sad once in a while.
Mm-hmm.
That's called life.
Yeah, you're right.
That clock is wrong. Tim.
All right, morning.
Morning.
Welcome to worship today. Announcements. So first, as I see Herman fanning himself, next week we move downstairs to the big classroom. It's all been redone, so it looks nice. It'll look very worshipful, and it has air conditioning. So we'll move down there next week, and we'll be down there for July and August like we normally are, and then we'll move back up here after Labor Day. Want to take a minute to especially thank Tim, and to thank went right out of my head. Ellen and Chris for all of the work on that room downstairs. It looks spectacular. If you haven't seen it yet, new ceiling, new paint, new carpets, new drapes will be up. I think they're doing whatever they need to them. So it is great, and I want to thank them for all their hard work for that. You'll notice up here, this is all of the stuff that we've collected for the quarter. I was talking to Ellen and said, you know, we're doing a great job, you know, bringing stuff in and donating and partnering with other people, but, you know, we never actually see the fruits of our labor. And so at the end of each quarter, we're going to have our stuff up here so we can see the fruits of our labor, but also we're going to pray over the stuff for the people that are actually getting this, that they can use it and in some ways can be connected and feel the work of Christ in their lives. I have another announcement. You'll see on the back there's this little purple thing. I also put it on the Facebook page, if you're on the Facebook page. As you know, my granddaughter has hearing loss. That's Bailey. And our family supports the Walk for Hearing, which is a group that fundraises for awareness around hearing loss and hearing health. And so every year we do the walk, and our team, it's called Bailey's Besties, raises money to donate for that. And so one of the things that we're doing this year is a fundraiser. It's bingo. It's bingo. It'll be downstairs. If you remember ever coming to one of the youth bingos, it's going to be the same kind of thing. I can tell you that there are lots and lots and lots and lots of gift cards to be won, gift baskets to be raffled. There'll be food and fun. Now they put some kind of you pay online. For you guys here, you know Sarah. If you want to come, email or text her, say, hey, I'm going to come. We just put you on the list, and you can settle up with her later. But it should be a good time. Should be a good time. I know there's Cheesecake Factory. I know there's Texas Roadhouse. For those, there's Tom's Pizza. You might not know those. Good Pizza. There's First Watch. Lots of good ones that we can win. All right. Any other announcements for the good of the fellowship? Oh, I got. So tomorrow is the last Bible study for Monday night Bible study for July. We're taking July off, and then we're going to start again in August. It's a study in the book of Exodus. It's going to be Exodus in like 18 weeks. So on Zoom, no prior knowledge necessary. You don't have to commit to like the whole thing. If you can come 1 week and you know, in and out, that's fine too. All right, any other announcements for the good of the fellowship? All right, hearing none, let's stand and sing our opening hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King, number 43.
Burn.
creatures are precious. There is nothing covered up that will not be revealed, nothing hidden that will not be made known. For you are great and do remarkable things. You and you alone are truly God. Sparrows are cheap, but not even one of them falls to the ground outside of your heavenly Father's circle of love. Let us pray together. Most wonderful God, we praise you for the riches of love that enable us to come together in this house of prayer to celebrate your goodness. Please lead our truant minds away from petty concerns to larger commitments, away from tiredness or apathy towards a sense of awe and wonder, away from the self-obsession of the holiest intoxication of your awesome beauty, humble power, and your unspeakable love. We realize we never seem to be able to thank, praise, and enjoy, but we do pray to be able to give you the best worship that at this time is possible, through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. As we continue worship today, let us present God, his tithes, and our morning offerings.
As you're able, and let us sing, "People Need the Lord." Ah, here it is.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for your continual love that showered out upon us. And we thank you, Father, for your Son, Jesus. And we ask, Father, that you would use these gifts here in this place and across the world so your Spirit can draw people closer to Jesus and closer to you. We thank you. We praise you for all this, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
first reading is on page 17 of your pew Bibles. It's Genesis chapter 21, beginning at verse 8. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abram, on account of his son. But God said to Abram, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abram rose early in the morning and took the bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot, for she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. So she went and filled the skin of water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up, and he lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. The second reading is on page 156 of the Pew Bibles. It's Romans chapter 6, verses 1 to 11. What then are we to say? Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too walk in the newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. And the third reading is from the Gospel on page 10 of your pew Bibles. It's Matthew chapter 10. Beginning with verse 24, going through 39. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house, Beelzebul? How much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing is secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both the soul and the body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone who acknowledges me before the others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find life will lose it, and those who lose life for my sake will find it. This is the word of God.
Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the opportunity we have to gather in your name. We thank you that you give us the privilege to worship you as we pray, as we sing, as we listen to your word. We pray, Father, that not only would it bring honor and glory to your name, we pray that in some way it would connect us with you and your spirit so that we can be renewed. We can be refreshed, that we can be prepared to leave this place and go out and to minister in your name. For it's in the name above all other names, the name of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus, who is the Christ, that we pray. Amen. All right, so put on your imagination hats for a minute. And so we're starting a new business. We have a new pen company, P-E-N, you know, the thing you write with. So we have a new pen, all right? And, you know, it's a good pen. It's a great pen. It writes well. It's smooth. It's bold in its colors. And, you know, it's cheap. And you are the hiring manager. And you need to hire some folks to come and work at this pen company. So what would your headline for Indeed or for Monster be? You're trying to attract some people to come and work at your pen company. Go ahead, Tim. All right, good benefits. Good benefits. So, all right, so come work for us because we got good benefits. All right. And you know, you can work for home and make your own hours.
Friday
is
work.
What's that?
Friday.
All right, come work for us because we're like family.
New product for you to be on the cutting edge.
All right, come work with us in our cutting technology and pen creation or whatever. Of our pen pals. Go ahead, Tim. All right, come work for us and reap the benefits and the money. All right. point. So, you know, we would want to do something to kind of make it attractive, right? Because you know, you're trying to reel people in. Now, what if the headline was, "Beware, people are going to be angry at you." Tim's got a grumpled face there, and he's saying no. No. Well, you know what? Today, in our scripture, that's the headline that Jesus is using for discipleship, for ministry in his name. He's, you know, if we look at this scripture that Mark read for us, you know, and we go, you know, we kind of think about, okay, what is it all about? In one sentence is, following Jesus is going to make others angry. Following Jesus is going to make others angry. And so if that were the headline on Monster or Indeed, how many people do you think are going to say, oh, sign me up? Not many at all. Well, the good news here is Jesus isn't advertising for anyone and everyone to come. You know, here we are in Matthew. It's a second discourse. The way Matthew is set up, he kind of has like a sermon and then kind of teaching and miracles and stuff, and then another teaching, miracles and stuff, and then so on. And so this is the second discourse. First discourse, we know, most of us, it was the Sermon on the Mount. Okay, so we have the Sermon on the Mount, 4, 5, and then we had some, the calling of Matthew. We had some miracles happen. Remember, he raised somebody from the dead. He had a dinner with tax collectors, which was a miracle in and of itself. He healed the woman of her bleeding. And now we're in the second discourse, and this discourse is called, you know, the discipleship discourse. And at the beginning of that, the good news is that Jesus wasn't putting out an advertisement looking for others. You know, he had already identified and appointed people to go out. And that's where we have the calling of the 12. So Jesus says, you. So there, it's not a one ad. It's an appointment that's been given. And as Jesus says to these folks, because, you know, quite frankly, I'm like you. If that were the advertisement, he wouldn't get many people that would be signing up. And so I think the first thing when we think about this idea of discipleship is that we don't choose God. God chooses us. We don't choose God. God chooses us first. You know, when we think about it, you know, we're Wesleyans, right? Everybody shake your head. You're sitting in a United Methodist church, so our theology is Wesleyan. And so one of the big things that marks us as Wesleyan is our idea of grace. You know, our idea of grace, and part of that grace is the movement of God that goes out into the world that interacts with us first. And so, you know, people are out there, you know, think about, you know, the disciples, they were out there. And, you know, it says that Jesus called them and said what? Follow me. And it's quite remarkable. Here's Peter, James, and John, and they're out in their boats, and they're doing their thing. And Jesus says, come and follow me. And what do we hear? They drop their stuff and go and follow. Matthew was here at his toll booth. Okay? Jesus was by himself. He didn't have anything. He didn't need to claim anything. But here he stops by at Matthew's booth and says what? Come follow me. And it says that Matthew immediately left the toll booth and came and followed him. And so, you know, for me, that's remarkable. But, you know, as I think about it, what happens there? And I believe God's Spirit was already at work in their hearts and in their heads to prepare them for that invitation. And that same Spirit was at work in each one of those disciples, preparing them for this divine appointment. And so, you know, here is Jesus, and he says, look, I want you. And what does he say? You are my disciples, and I am going to send you out. All right, so if you're a disciple, you're someone that's going out, what's the first thing that you need to know, or the first thing that you need to have your mind wrapped around? Huh? All right, so we need to know where we are going. And so last week, we talked about that, right? He says you're going to go out into the towns in and around Galilee. Remember, it says that in that beginning scripture, it says that Jesus was touring around the region. So he had been going around, so people had already known Jesus. And so he's going to send them out into those regions. And he's sending them out locally first. You know, because if we get too big a region where the geography looks too big, what's going to happen? We're going to get overwhelmed. Okay, so we want to know where we're going first. What else do we want to know? All right, great. What are we going to tell them? What are we going to tell them? You know, so if you're ever going to teach something, what do you need to know? And so, what happens?
Study it.
All right. So, you need to study it. So, first of all, you need to know what it is you are teaching. But teachers amongst us, we got a couple here, at least one besides me. Hey, Deb, you were going to go. Debbie this week was hanging out with kids. She was feeling young again. St. Joe's. And so Deb was, you know, she was doing stuff that, quite frankly, I don't understand. It's something about lasers hitting wires and making circles on the wall or something like that. But how did you know, Deb, what you were supposed to be doing?
I learned it years ago.
All right, so you learned it years ago. Okay, you learned it years ago, but what, you know, how did you know what they wanted you to do? Instructions, and sometimes in instructional language, we call those objectives. You know, so sometimes I'm asked to go teach and do lectures at schools, and you know, it's like, and they do that because I have a certain body of knowledge that, you know, I'm really good at. And so they say, hey, you're good at this, can you come teach it? And so it's okay, I'm going to come teach. What am I going to teach? And they give you a set of, they're called objectives. You to teach about diabetes. Okay, what do I want to teach about diabetes? What's the epidemiology? Okay, what are the signs and symptoms? What are the laboratory findings? What are the treatments? You know, so on and so forth. And so Jesus has given these disciples some missional objectives. What do you think those missional objectives are? Disciples to make God known. But is it just to get more people to follow Jesus, or is there something sort of even kind of deeper than that?
To love.
Huh? Okay, to love one another.
To care for each other.
Well, okay, so as you think about the scripture for a minute, did it sound like there was a whole heck of a lot of care? achieve peace, there needs to be some ruckus that goes on. And so, you know, I'm sitting here and I'm wrestling with this stuff. And, you know, we listen to Jesus, and is this text here, you know, mother against mother and son, mother against daughter and son against, is this new to Jesus? Did he just make it up on the fly? No. Where did it come from?
History.
What history?
Well,
it could have been from Hagar, but really where it comes from, and almost verbatim, is from the book of Malachi. Keep your fingers, if you've got your Bibles open, keep your fingers in Matthew, and flip on back to Malachi. Okay, if you look at Malachi chapter number 7, you know, you go down and like verse number 5 on, you know, down it says, the son treats the father with contempt. The daughter rises up against her mother. The daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Your enemies are members of your own household. Sounds very familiar to what Jesus was saying. And so in some ways, as we think about this missional component of Jesus, he's hyperlinking it back to the book of Malachi, okay? And so, not Malachi, Micah, sorry. So as we think about this, what is the big thing in Micah? Well, so if we look at the overall problem of Micah, what's going on? It's a matter of injustice. It's where, you know, what does the Lord require of you? That you act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. All right, so that's the missional statement. So if you think about this commissioning of the 12 disciples, okay, he's appointing them by name and saying, to see you. And in some ways, as we think about that, then, you know, we go back to the gospel, and it's in 24, it says, a disciple's not above his master, okay? Or a disciple's not above his teacher, nor a slave above his master. And so, in some ways, what he's saying as he brings this together, okay, we got this disciple thing, teacher and disciple, we got slave and master, and how are they integrated? In some ways, Jesus is saying the same thing, because a disciple is supposed to be a reflection of the rabbi. And in some ways, if you're a disciple, you become a slave to your rabbi. If you're ever going and getting an advanced degree, you're going to get your PhD, okay? And if you're getting your PhD, you're the slave to the person who's working with you, to that academic who's working with you. And that's what Jesus is saying is here, you're going to see, when they see you, they see me. They see you, they see me. And when they see me through you, they're going to see this mission. Think about Jesus. You know, in the Gospel of Luke, it says that Jesus came out of the desert and he went and he preached his first sermon. How did that first sermon go? You're shaking your head like this. So did he fall flat on his face?
Yeah.
He nearly got killed is what happened. And so if we... Yeah. So says that, you know, they're receiving him at the synagogue, and he's taken his place, and he's going to sit down, and he's going to teach. So he opens the scroll, and he reads from Isaiah. Okay? And he talks about, injustices being overturned. And he says, you know, it's a messianic kind of scroll that, you know, here when we have these injustices that are being overturned and righted, it's, you know, that's the signs of this messianic age, the sign of peace that we talk about. And, you know, everybody's, then Jesus turns it on them and says, you are the ones that are causing injustice. You're the ones that cause folks to be oppressed. You're the ones that ignore the poor. You're the ones who push people to the fringe. And all of a sudden, what happens? They get angry. They get mad. They get mad to the point where they take him to the top of the hill where he walks out the top of the hill, and they're going to push him over. So, father against son, mother against daughter. And so, when we look at this commission, when we look at this idea of father against son, mother against, you know, Jesus is hyperlinking back to Micah and saying, okay, here is the mission. Here are the objectives. And we're going to go out. And we are going to right wrong. And so, you know, we think about, okay, you know, so he's being called out, and, you know, we're supposed to go out, and, you know, they're supposed to see Jesus in the world, and the mission is, you know, focused on injustice. But how is it supposed to happen? How's it supposed to happen? How's it supposed to happen? So, what's it say in the scripture? What's it say in the scripture? What I say to you in the dark, tell others in the light. What you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetop. And so when we think about that, you know, and when we, okay, what you're told in the dark, say in the light, what's been whispered to you, proclaim it from the rooftops. So in some ways, what Jesus is saying is, you know, this mission that you're on is got to be one that where we've taken the stuff that we've heard, the stuff that we've learned, and it now becomes public. It becomes visible. All right, think about if you're doing something in the dark, can people see it? No, but if it's done in the light, people can see it. And then, you know, things that have been whispered to you, only you're going to hear. In some ways, as we think about this, we have to think about it more like an ancient Israelite. And so, you know, when we think about their buildings, you know, they were one, maybe two-story with flat roofs. And so, you know, if someone wanted to make a public you know, as Jesus is sitting here talking about, you know, this mission, and the mission is Micah to do justice, to love mercy, and to follow God humbly, okay? And we know that, okay, if we do that, it's going to, you know, cause a bit of a ruckus, maybe in our families, maybe in our extended families, maybe in our neighborhoods, maybe in the greater world, but we know that to fulfill justice is going to create anxiety. It's going to create anger. Because by its very nature, if I'm one that's seeking justice, what's going to happen? Injustice usually comes when, you know, one person in some form, in some way, you know, by most likely power, you know, subverts someone else. And so in some ways, when we're looking at changes in injustice, we're looking at changes in injustice, it's power dynamics. And coming against those power dynamics, and that's going to create issues. But Jesus says, look, you know, it's not good enough that you keep this private. It's not good enough that you just, you know, kind of keep it to yourself. You know, what you need to do now as part of this mission is it needs to be visible. It needs to be vocal. It needs to be out there. Now, how many people sign me up for that? Because that sounds like fun. No, it's very uncomfortable. And in some ways, you know, if we're called to something very uncomfortable, what does it do? It creates what? Anxiety. Also creates a sense of fear. Why does it create anxiety and fear? Okay, so you're out of your comfort zone, so things that you might not necessarily be gifted with. Says that, you know, this is going to create anxiety, it's going to create fear. But what does Jesus say? He says three times in Scripture, don't fear, don't be afraid. Don't fear, don't be afraid. And so when we look at the word and, you know, the way it's set up, you know, in Greek, it's in the aorist tense. You know, you got past, present, there's a chorus. And that means kind of ongoing. Okay? So it means don't be stymied by a ongoing sense of fear. Okay? Don't let your life be so filled with fear, so filled with anxiety, that it paralyzes you. Okay? And so, you know, what we're called to do is a little fearful. You know, it's going to put us, you know, in competition with other people. But Jesus says, don't get so overwhelmed that your life is full of fear. For their fear.
To not be afraid?
Yeah. You know, I get this in my office like all the time. And I'm sure that, you know, permanents who do as well. You get people that come in and they sit down and they tell you, I'm anxious. Okay? And you know, maybe, you know, within their family, they think that you can just kind of will away this anxiousness. And so, you know, family will come in and say, well, just don't be angry or anxious. What happens when you tell an anxious person not to be anxious?
They get more anxious.
So, you know, just becomes a sparrow? All of those, and that your Father in heaven knows everything that's going on. So if he knows about sparrows, then he certainly want to know about you. If he loves sparrows, he's certainly going to have more love on you. And so, you know, one of the things that we worry about when we're anxious and fearful is tell them, hey, look, yeah, this message, this mission that I'm giving you is a tough one. It's tough. But you don't go alone. You don't go alone. Because, you know, one of the things, you know, why do we sometimes do the things we do and we act the way we act is because we don't want to be rejected. So Jesus has given us a tough mission, a mission to be like him. And if we're going to be like him, it says that we need to do what? Take up our cross and follow him. Now, typically when we hear about take up your cross and follow him, we think about, okay, we need to suck it up. Take up your cross and follow me into ministry. And so we think about the cross as self-sacrifice. But, you know, if we think, and that's our kind of 21st century sensibility here, because, you know, that's what we've been kind of brought up on. But if you were Matthew or you were Peter, James, and John, and you're hearing about, you know, cross, take up your cross and follow me, against the power that was. They were coming up against the power of Rome. And so when Jesus is saying, take up your cross, okay, they understood, okay, I'm going to get crucified. But it's crucified because I'm coming up against the powers in the world that are oppressive. One more link back to this scripture in Micah. talking about justice. So if we are the church and we are going to be missional people, okay, what are we to be about? Yeah, we're supposed to be about love. We're supposed to be about love. But we're supposed to be about injustice as well. In a second, we're going to pray over stuff. What's the stuff we have here? We got some Pampers. We got some Zest. We got some toothpaste. We got all kinds of Tide and Extra and Gain. So, soap powder and all that stuff. But that's just stuff. What's it really about? It's about people. Okay, so it's about people. So when we look at this stuff, hopefully we're looking at not just giving stuff, but giving something to people. But what else are we doing? So, we do that, but it can become much deeper than that. All right, it's given to the poor. It's in some ways trying to help remind people they have dignity, that they are loved, that they are children of God. And so, in some ways, this is a small attempt to help fill the gap in homelessness. Next month, we're going to be doing domestic abuse.
For the kids,
but it's supporting the Delaware County Domestic Abuse Project, or whatever they call themselves. But it's not about snacks for kids. It's about reminding them that they're not forgotten. Huh? That somebody cares. The radical mission of Jesus Christ. It's about looking and seeing injustice, calling it what it is, and working in some way, in some form, to fix it. Let's pray. Well, hold on. So, everybody stand up. Everybody stand up. People at home, stand up. So we're going to pray, but typically it's me praying and you guys sitting there doing nothing. We're praying for stuff, so I know it's going to feel a little weird. Put your hands out. Put your hands out like that. All right? Focus on this stuff. We're going to pray up on this. Father God, we thank you. We thank you that you blessed each one of us with the ability to bless others. And so, Father, I thank you first and foremost for all that have been generous and have given these things. But Father, now in this time and in this place, we pray for each item that is here, down to the smallest little bottle of soap, that it would touch a person. Here today, I thank you that they're here. Whether they're here in person, whether they're here online, whether they're here today, tomorrow, and next week. Father, I pray your blessing upon them. I pray, Father, that as we are commissioned to be your disciples, that you would help us to be people that go out and in spite of the temptation to be anxious and fearful, that we remember that we don't go alone, that we go with you. And we pray, Father, that we would be brave enough to move from the dark to the light, from the whispers to the to the rooftops so that we can be your people. Father, I pray today for Julie. I pray that whatever health issue you have, that you would restore her. Father, we pray for all of those that we've been praying for. We pray for Nicole. We pray for Harry. We pray for our other Harry. We pray for Mike. We pray for Mary and her family, and all those folks that we've been praying for that are in need of your healing. We thank you. We praise you for all this. We pray in the matchless name of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know, when we combat injustice, when we remind people that they are indeed worthy and children of God, that's when we'll have peace. We have peace that flows almost like a river. So I invite you to join your voices as we sing I've Got Peace Like a River. It's a bulletin in this church. Is there a bulletin insert?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh. Inside.
All right, I didn't get one. That's fine.
Everyone, ahead, just follow me.
Go with God's peace. Be Jesus in the world. Go with us.